rescue. Oh. Welcome to Sunday Morning Live. Before we get going, I just want to bring an impartation that we are not about religion. It's amazing because we were brought up in religion, so every time when the word Jesus comes into effect, we always think religious. And this is not about religion. God never intended religion. He intended to bring truth because this is about a kingdom and a citizenship with a king, soldiers, and an eternal place. This has never been about religion. This is not a religious Bible. This is a manual. It's a training manual. And if you don't get this into your heart, how can you have victory? Because these are bullets that fill the Holy Ghost bazooka. Amen? So this is not, we need to erase the arena of religion. This is not about religious. Number one, God wants you to know him as a father and you be a son and daughter. That's the number one most important thing. You can't go on any further until that's happened. To where you know his voice. To where you know his unction. To where you desire his presence. You know you can't live without his presence. It's nothing. You know, that's why he's called the Most High. Because in that presence, you get high. I love to get high. The problem was, before Christ, I was using everything that was from the enemy. And the ripple effect was destructive. I still get high. But I don't get high on counterfeit. I get high on the true high. That's God's presence. Why? Because that's where we came from. That's why everybody wants to feel good. I want to feel good. Why do you want to feel good? Because you came from the presence of God. The greatest feel good you could have. The Most High. Amen? So in that, that's why when Jesus came, he said, look, I made an exchange for you. And in this exchange, and it wasn't about religion, it was to be free from religion. It was to be free from rituals. It was to have an established relationship as a son and as a daughter where he comes and you know and he speaks to you and you know what's going on. You're no longer left in the dark. You're in the light. And that light that lives in you allows you to see. And if that light has been dimmed, it's hard to see. Listen, we are in the last days. Amen? These are the last days. And of course, they've been saying this for years, haven't they?
It's the last days.
These are the last days. And we'll continue to say it. But there's something very important. Prophetically, we're watching things unfold. Quickly. Even Jesus said that there would be a generation that would come, that would worship me. There's more worship going up than there ever has been. There's more music in the kingdom than there's ever been. True worshipers the Father looks for. He said there would be a generation that would seek me and know me. There would be a generation to be thirsty and hungry for my presence and my truth. There would be a generation that I would come and return to. He said, but first, Israel must become a nation. Israel became a nation in 1948, a generation of 70 years. The fulfillment of generation is 2018. That's prophetic. Now, we don't know exactly the perfect day or time, do we? But the next feast to be fulfilled is the Feast of Trumpets, which is the removal of the body of Christ. And only those that are sealed and know him will be removed. The rest will go through tribulation. So we are in end time. Such powerful time. What a wonderful time to be alive. Powerful. But it's going to be a terrible time for those that don't know him. That's why we must get out so they do get to know him. We must be an extension of his hand and his feet and his mouth. And be ready in season and out to rescue all those who've been taken captive. Amen? And support everything that has to do with the kingdom. Yeah, and you can't put better, look at, you can buy all the stock, but you can't put better stock than in the kingdom of God. Amen? Why? Because then you know that it's touching a life. It's touching a life, not just filling a pocket. It's touching a life. Oh, glory. Let's go to 1 John chapter 5. Hallelujah. How many of you all want to touch a life? Amen. Amen. I have a message from the Lord. In 1 John chapter 5. In verse 1 and 2, let's speak it together, because what you speak is what you eat is what you become. You know, God says, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. His own people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Many people have no idea what's going on around them. Number one is because, how could you if you don't eat this? I speak to many people that say, I'm a believer, but don't read the Word of God. They're not a believer. Because the word believe means to follow. And then they approve of things that the devil approves of, and they're going to be judged just like the devil will be. And they have no idea. People bring accursed items in their homes. They still play the rituals of demonic forces. They still read horoscopes, gold palm readers, psychics, put statues in their homes, Buddhas and little fat jolly demons and all of these fake angels and all of these other stuff. Those are nothing but accursed items. They draw demonic activity. And you can't go any further. It puts limitations on your growth in the spirit. Why? My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. There's faith based on knowledge. There's faith based on relationship. There's faith based on experience. Faith. Faith based. In 1 John chapter 5 and verse 1, would you read it with me? Whoever what? Believes that Jesus is the Christ is born of God, and everyone who loves him who begot also loves him who is begotten of him. By this we know that we love the children of God when we love God and his commandments. These commandments are not the Ten Commandments. They are the Word of God. Anything God speaks becomes a command. Amen? So, see, but religion goes back to the Ten Commandments and nobody could fulfill them anyways. They're already fulfilled in you by the power of God. So in this, these commands are what God speaks to you every day. It speaks to you through his word and through his voice. But if you don't know his voice, it makes it difficult. Amen. Now, there's something important I want to share before we even go any further. Number one, the word believe means to what? Follow. It says those who follow or believe that Jesus is the Christ. Now, let me explain something about the word Christ. Jesus is the Christ. Jesus is God who came into this realm. The Bible, the word says that God prepared a body for himself. Has everybody got this? So he prepared a body for himself. His body was not made of the dust. His body was made from the word. He created his own blood. In fact, that's why Mary was impregnated by the Holy Spirit. That was the Spirit of the Father. So who came? He had to come into this realm to become man so he could pay a price and make an exchange. Amen. He was setting up an eternal port for people to go home through. Amen. It's called the tabernacle. So in this, when God came, he came through the womb. He came forth. His body was made of the Word of God. He was the Father. In Jesus. He named him Jesus. He said, look, here's my calling card. My name's Jesus. 1-800-G-O-D. So here God comes into this realm. Now, I want you to know what the word Christ means. It means anointed one. Now, where does this anointed one? He says, those who believe that Jesus is the Christ. So he's more than just the Son of God. God took a part of himself and called him Son. But the Christ means I am the eternal presence of God, the eternal truth, and the eternal power of God, all in Jesus the Christ. So when you see that word Jesus, you don't just look at some Jesus as a man, some religious aspect. Jesus, the Christ, is God Almighty who came in the eternal presence, power, and truth of himself. Does everybody get it? And so when he came by the Spirit, his own Spirit came in. So he sent himself into the womb, put on a body made of the Word of God, not of the dust. That was the only way he could get into hell, was to take on man's sin, because that was a qualification to get into hell. Or else he couldn't go to hell. So he took on all man's sin, shed his blood, because his blood was no sin. It was pure, it was not contaminated. And when he went to hell, he took the keys of death, hell, and the grave, and the power that was given to Satan's kingdom. He took it away only to those who follow him. Not to those who don't follow him, because they're still under his power. Only to those who follow Jesus. So everybody got it? Okay, now we can go a little further. Exodus 36. Oh, hallelujah. It's a great day for training. Let's go to Ezekiel 36 instead. Oh, come on. They both begin with an E. Ezekiel 36. In verse 22. Now, when God speaks about Israel, he also speaks about the body of Christ. Has everybody got it? Let's speak it. Therefore, say to the house of Israel, the Lord is speaking to Ezekiel as a prophet, and he's telling him, speak these things. Thus says the Lord, I do not do this for your sake, O house of Israel, but for my holy name's sake, which you have profaned among the nations wherever you went. Hello. Listen, before you and I were born again into the Spirit, we profaned the name of God. We did a lot of damning. Hello, GD. We did a lot of things. We cursed God's name. We did all kinds of stuff, didn't we? We profaned his name just the way we acted, the things that we did. In verse 23, he said, I will sanctify my great name, which has been profaned among the nations, which you have profaned in their midst, and the nations shall know that I am the Lord, says the Lord God, when I am what? Hallowed, feared, honored, respect in you before their eyes. When I am honored, hallowed. The greatest way that you can tell God that you love him and you acknowledge him is worship. Worship. Man, I love God's presence. I can't live without God's presence. There isn't enough money that can pay me to get out of God's presence. Or people. Hallelujah. Now in verse 24. For I will take you from all among the nations and gather you out of all the countries and bring you to your land. Listen, every one of us came from another country. Amen. Verse 25. And then I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you shall be clean, and I will cleanse you from all your filthiness and from all of your what? Idols. How many of y'all know you could be your worst idol? I will give you a what? A new heart and put a new spirit within you. Hallelujah. That's called born again. And I will take the heart of stone out of your flesh, that rebellious heart, and I'll give you a heart of flesh. Now look at this. Are you ready for 27? And I will put what? My spirit, the spirit of the Father called the Holy Spirit, within you and cause you to walk in my statutes. Why? Because you will have power when you get baptized in the Holy Spirit, not water. And you will keep my judgments in what? And you'll do them. Then you shall dwell in the land that I gave to your fathers. You shall be my people, and I'll be your God. And I will deliver you from all uncleanness. I will call for the grain and multiply it and bring no famine upon you. In other words, that's where God comes and says, I've come to bring you life and life abundantly. Does everybody get this? See, when Jesus came, and he hung on the cross, he paid the price, and an exchange was made, right? The Christ of God is called the anointing that it exchanged by the exchange on the cross by the price that Jesus paid on the cross. He paid that price on the cross to exchange so that you and I could have an opportunity to be filled and baptized with the Holy Spirit. Salvation is one stage. There's another stage called the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And too many people gets caught up in just salvation and not power. Does everybody get it? Well, I'm okay with salvation. Well, what about the power so you can overcome? Amen? Look at the power of God is what rose Jesus from the dead. It's called the anointing. That's what rose Jesus from the dead. Amen? And he released the anointing to me and you, to those who are followers. It's called the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is a carrier of the anointing. It is the Spirit of the Father. So he said, look it, I'm going to clean you. I'm going to cleanse you with water. Water doesn't mean physical washing. Water means the Word of God. I'm going to cleanse you with the water. So if you're not reading the Word of God, speaking the Word of God, how can you be cleansed? You can't. See, the blood, what cleansing means, I'm washed by the blood of Christ. The blood of Jesus goes before the Spirit. That's why Jesus had to die on the cross before he could release the Holy Spirit to mankind. That's why you got to repent of your sins before you can receive the Holy Spirit. Because the blood washes first, then the Spirit follows. Does everybody got it? Now the Spirit will draw you to get you to repent so you can confess and turn from your ways that are ungodly. And then he desires to fill you with the Holy Spirit. But he will not fill you unless you desire it. He won't give you anything unless you seek it. So everybody got it? Acts chapter 1. Acts chapter 1 and verse 4. Is everybody there? Acts chapter 1 and verse 4. Now Jesus was assembled with them, okay? Jesus rose from the dead. He appeared to them. And he said to them, what? Being assembled together with them, he did what? He commanded. Now this is powerful. He commanded them. He didn't ask them. He commanded them. What did he command them to do? Not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you have heard from me. For John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with what? The Holy Spirit not many days from now. Jesus was commanding them to receive and wait for the baptism, to seek the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Why? So they can be witnesses to him. So they can overcome the world. Look at verse 8. What does it say? But you shall receive what? Power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. Listen, this was just to the disciples as the beginning, but it's for all men. All men. Go to Acts 2 in verse 1. Fifty days after Jesus rose from the dead, he hung around for 10 days and he went. And he breathed on his disciples and said, here's enough of my presence till you can hang tough, till you can go up in the upper room and get filled with the Holy Spirit. I'm going to come to you by Spirit now. Now, he told 500 disciples this. Has everybody got it? 500 he told. You know how many showed up? 120. The rest started denominations. They started the religious garbage. In verse 1, it says, when the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place, because they obeyed God and said they waited. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then there appeared to them divided tongues as a fire, and one sat upon each of them. Why? Because they became the tabernacle of God, just like the cloud of glory that was over the tabernacle and the cloud of fire. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with what? Other tongues. As the Spirit gave them what? Evidence. They began to speak in another language. Does everybody get this? Why? They're speaking directly to the Father. Something occurred. Now go to verse 38. Oh, hallelujah. In verse 38, it says, then Peter said to them, because Peter rebuked them. He said, you guys are all religious. You don't understand what's going on. This is a fulfillment of what Joel prophesied, the prophet Joel, that I would pour out my spirit in those days. And men and my maid servants and men servants would have dreams and visions. They'd be speaking in funny languages. People wouldn't get it. In verse 38, then Peter said to them, repent. Again, when you repent, you are washing with the blood of Christ. And let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for remission of sins. And you shall receive what? The gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promises to you and to your children and to all who are far off, as many as the Lord our God called. So if you believe that you've been called, there's more to you than just life itself here in this realm. There's eternal life, which is much more important than this life. Amen. Tongues of fire. In other words, what began to happen is they got filled, they got baptized. The eternal presence, power, and truth of God Almighty came into them by the Holy Spirit. But again, look at it. I was brought up in religion. I didn't know. I didn't know I could have a relationship with God. I didn't know about the power and the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Man, you did a couple of genuflections, put a few cents in the thing and prayed sometimes to a statue or did whatever. You did religious acts, but nobody really taught the Word of God. There was really no true teachings and impartations. It was all a ritual. I left there the same way I went in. No power. Dead works, dead churches. No true worship. No true desire to touch God's heart where he can touch yours. Not looking for a pure healing from the heaven. Acknowledging that he is the healer and the deliverer and the one that can free you and empower you so that you can do the same works as him. 1 John chapter 5, let's go back. Is everybody there? 1 John chapter 5. We're going to read verse 1 and 2 again. What does it say? Whoever believes that Jesus is the Christ, which is the eternal presence, power, and truth of God Almighty, amen, in the body of Jesus, is born of God. And everyone who loves him, who begot, also loves him, who is begotten of him. By this we know that we love the children of God when we love God and keep his commands or desires in his word. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments. And his commandments are not what? Burdensome. Why? Because you've been empowered by the Spirit of God when you are baptized. You don't even look at whether you're obeying the commandments. You do. You have no desire to lie, cheat, exaggerate, manipulate, anything. Steal. It's gone. Why? Because the word says you are a new creation in Christ. In Christ means in the power, the eternal presence, power, and truth of God Almighty by the Spirit of God. Forever is born of God, verse 4, overcomes the world. What do you mean? The lust of the eye, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. The influence of the world. They overcome it. And this is the victory that has overcome the world. It's our what? Your what? Faith. Your what? Faith. Your faith. Who is he who overcomes the world but he who believes that Jesus is the Son of God or the Christ? Your faith. It's called connecting faith. Faith. Faith is the victory that overcomes the world influences as a son or a daughter, as a servant, as a steward, as a soldier, and as an ambassador of Jesus Christ. We are witnesses of the eternal kingdom. This is the connecting faith to the eternal unseen truth of God Almighty. Now the word says that faith comes by hearing the word of God. Go to Hebrews 11. Connecting faith. Now I want to tell you what faith is. F-A-I-T-H. Are you ready? Faith, okay, it's the foundation accepted in the heavenlies. Faith is the foundation accepted in the heavenlies. Has everybody got it? My Father's a ruler of the heavenlies. Faith accepted in the heavenlies. A foundation accepted in the heavenlies. Why? It's accepted as the foundation. Faith. Now, there's more to this than that, and I don't have all day to go through it, but anyway. Hebrews 11, we'll go there. Hebrew. Anybody brew this morning? Hebrew, she brew, I brew. Hebrews 11 and verse 1. Let's speak it. Now faith is the what? Faith is the what? That's the connection. Faith is a substance that connects. Now, faith is the substance of the things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. For by it the elders obtained a good testimony. By faith we understood that the worlds were framed by the what? Word of God. So what is the substance of faith? The Word of God. So if you don't know the Word of God, you are not walking in faith. You live in assumption. And heaven ain't behind you. Hell is. Faith. By faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the Word of God so that the things which are seen were not made of the things which are visible. God, when God spoke, nobody saw His words, did they? When God decided to create the universe, He took a chunk out of eternity and said, I'm going to create a universe. Now I'm going to put a time sequence, the beginning and an end. I'm the Alpha and the Omega in this universe. And one day this universe is going to fold up. It's going to go. Everything's going to burn out. God said, I'm going to burn everything. I'm going to bring my people into a place called eternal. There'll no more be a place of temporary. And that's coming. Oh, hallelujah. Okay, so faith is the substance. The substance is the Word of God. So if you're not eating, Jesus said, man cannot live by bread alone, but every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God, that's how we live. That's how we compare things. That's how we judge things, by fruit. Amen. We don't approve of what the world approves of because you'll be judged according to the world. I don't approve of same-sex marriage. I don't approve of abortion. I don't approve of fornication. I don't approve of any of those things. I used to BC because I was a part of it. But I'm no longer of this world. I'm an eternal being, not a temporary anymore. It's totally different. But that cannot happen until you are born in the Spirit. Other than that, you still look at things naturally. Call yourself a believer, but approve of the things that approve of a sin. Because man approves it, the government approves it, you approve it. Wrong. Wrong. That's why we got so much conflict. Even in this country, people approving of all of these things. Well, they just let them live their own life. I don't approve of it. I'm not going to vote for someone that approves of same-sex marriage. Because that's nothing but a demon in a person, and people don't get it. Believe me, when I had my visitation from the Lord and that demon came out of me, I never used drugs again. We're not fighting flesh and blood. We're fighting spirits, powers of darkness, wickedness in heavenly places. And if we don't learn how to fight in the Spirit and get in the Spirit, you can't overcome. Is everybody okay? Hebrew 4. Hebrew 4 and verse 11. Hebrews 4, verse 11. Let's speak it. Let us therefore be diligent to enter that rest, lest anyone fall according to the same example of disobedience. For the word of God is what? Living and what? Powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit and joints and marrow, and is the discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. There is no creature hidden from his sight. But you notice he says his sight. Why? Because he is the Word. But all things are naked and open to the eyes of him to whom we must give account. So the Word of God is substance. The Word says faith comes by hearing the Word of God. It's what connects me and you. Faith is a tangible substance. It's the word of God that connects. There's two things that connect me and you. See, one of the things the enemy doesn't ever want you to do is get connected. Or when you get connected, he wants to disconnect you. So you look at your accomplishments as fulfillment. My accomplishments are not fulfillment to me. I've accomplished nothing in my strength. Everything that I do, I give him glory, because if it wasn't for him, I wouldn't be here today. Does everybody get this? You can ask my wife that. You can ask my brother that too. If Ephesians 4. Connecting faith. What does it do? It connects you to home. Why? But you got to have something. You got to have the word of God. That's the substance of faith. Ephesians 4 and verse 11. And it says what? And he himself gave some to be what? Apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers. For what? The equipping of the saints for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come to the what? Unity of the? Ooh. Till we all come to the unity of the faith. So you and I are being trained by the word of God. So we all become to the unity of the faith. And the knowledge of the Son of God to a what? Perfect man. And to the measure of the stature of the fullness of. I want you to look at these two connections. He talks about the unity of the faith, right? And the fullness of Christ. The unity of faith and fullness of Christ. Because those two things are what connect me and you. The Holy Spirit is the one who connects. And faith connects. Does everybody get this? The Holy Spirit is the one who connects and faith connects. The unity of the faith and the fullness of Christ. The Holy Spirit is the connector to home. Faith is the substance that connects us to home, but also to each other. Does everybody grab this? I'm going to say it again. The Holy Spirit connects me and you to the eternal throne room of God. Why? Because the eternal throne room of God is where the presence of God is, the Father and the Son now, which has been released to you by his Spirit of the eternal presence and truth of God Almighty. That's what's connecting you. But there's another area where faith is connecting you, not only to that arena, but to each other, because it is the substance that connects us to one another if you are in the Word. If you're not in the Word, you are not connected. You can't be. You're disconnected. Why? Because you don't think the same way everyone else thinks. You don't see what everyone else sees. See, faith is not assumption. Faith is backed by the Word of God, which is substance. It's truth. In fact, the Word was with God who became flesh, right? So in this, as the Word of God is in each and every one of us, we see the same. We hear the same. We speak the same because we're from a different realm now. We're not from this realm anymore. Does everybody understand? You're no longer a man pleaser, you're a God pleaser. You're no longer looking at just the things of the present, you're looking at things of the future. You're no longer living from the past, you're living from the future because of what he says is who you are, causes you to be seated in heavenly places and blessed with every spiritual blessing as a joint heir of Christ and the righteousness of God from the future. I'm a traveler from the future now. I was sent from the throne room of God, just like you were. But the moment you and I were conceived, we lost all memory. We walked into this world saying, who am I? Why am I here? And where am I going? Until God drew you out of darkness and said, now I'm going to give you an opportunity. And when he drew you out of darkness, you accepted him as Lord and Savior, you repented for your sins. But that was the beginning. It wasn't the end. And too many stop right there, and it's done and over with. And they call themselves believers, and that's not true. Because there's more, much more. Amen? Now, faith is a substance that connects us to home and to each other by being like-minded. Again, faith is spiritual sight, and the foundation accepted in the heavenlies, the substance of the word of God. Philippians chapter 2. I'm not expecting you to get this all, but what you can grab, grab. Eat it. Eat it. And you can always go back on the website. You can go to eternallibrary.org and get all the teachings and learn. Philippians chapter 2. But if you're not willing to learn, you're going to end up getting burned. The enemy will burn you. He'll deceive you. And then he'll use you to burn somebody else. And if you fall back into sin, you're going to end up burning eternally. Ouch. Philippians chapter 2. Come on, Philip. There you are. In verse 1, Philippians 2, verse 1. You know, I wasn't born this way. I was born again this way. Amen. Glory to God. In verse 1, therefore, if there is what? Any consolation in Christ, in the anointing, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any affection and mercy, fulfill my joy by being what? Like-minded. How can you be like-minded if you don't get the word? You can't. Having the same love, being of one accord and of one mind, let nothing be done through selfish ambitions or a conceit, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than himself. Let each of you look out not only for his own interests, but others, for the interests of others. Let this mind be in you, which also was in who? Christ Jesus. Hello, does God want you to have his mind? You know how you earn God's trust? When you begin to see what he sees. Let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking a form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men. And being found in the appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even to the death of the cross. Therefore, God also has highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow of those in heaven and those on earth and those under the earth, that every tongue should confess that Jesus, the Christ, is the Lord, and to the glory of the Father. Like-minded, connected eternal. Well, connected where? Eternal home. We're homebound. You're home. See, when you are born again of the Spirit, all decisions, everything that you do is always a thought of connection of eternity. Amen? Now, the word says depart from evil. Amen? It doesn't mean you're going to be perfect. You're going to make mistakes. You repent and go on. Do you ever try and fix your mistake and make it worse? Hello, hello. That's when you let it go. Remember, man can't live by bread alone, but every word that comes from the mouth of God. Luke 14. Bear with me. We have to get this in because we have training on our internet. Training for reigning. So I only got about 40 more scriptures and we'll be good. Okay, I'm sorry. I'm only kidding. It's good to hear the pages turning on a Sunday morning. And if you're hot, just turn the page faster and you'll cool your neighbor off. Is anybody hot? Come on, you're all supposed to be hot. The word says don't be lukewarm. Luke 14, verse 25. Luke 14, verse 25. Now great multitudes went with him, Jesus, and he returned and said to them, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, wife and children, brothers, sisters, yes, and his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. Now that's pretty intense, isn't it? That doesn't mean you hate them. Does everybody get it? It means that God is number one. I love my wife, but I sever every emotional attachment with her and all my children and everything. Why? Because I don't want the enemy to use those emotions. Does everybody get it? I love my wife, but he's my life. She's my wife. There's a difference. That's the kid over there. He's my life. She's my child. Verse 27. Read it, sister. And whoever does not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my what? Disciple. For which of you intending to build a tower does not sit down first and count the cost, whether he has enough to finish it? Lest after he has laid the foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it begin to mock him, saying, this man began to build and was not able to finish. Ooh. Or what king going to make war against another king does not sit down first and consider whether he is able to, with 10,000, to meet him who comes against him with 20,000? Or else, while the other is still a great way off, he sends a delegation and asks conditions of peace. So likewise, whoever of you does not forsake all that he has cannot be my disciple. Now, again, there are people who are just willing to get saved and not be a disciple. That makes no sense, though, because a disciple is one who learns. So likewise, whoever you does not forsake all that he has cannot be my disciple. Salt is good, but if the salt has lost its flavor, how shall it be seasoned? That's why we're blessed and highly flavored. Yeah. It is neither fit for the land nor for the dunghill. In case you don't know what the dunghill is, look it up. But men threw it out. He who has an ear, let him what? Hear. Let him what? Hear, not listen. Listen says,
yeah, I got it, yeah.
Hearing says, I accept it, I receive it, I believe it, and I execute it. See, those who just listen don't put it into effect. Those who hear do. That's why God calls us to be hearers, not listeners. Are you ready? John chapter 8. John chapter 8, verse 31. Let's speak it together. Hallelujah. Then Jesus said to those Jews who followed him or believed him, if you what? If you abide in my word, you are my disciples. Indeed. And you shall what? Know the truth. Why? Because you're going to put it into practice because you're hearing it. Listeners don't put the word of God into practice. Only hearers do. And if you're going to put it into practice, what's going to happen? It's going to set you free from what? Sickness, disease, doubt, fear, your past, worry, oppression. You know how many people are on medication of oppression? It's incredible. Incredible. They're going to the doctor because they're oppressed. And the medication, did you ever read the side effects of medication that's oppressing? Suicide. So they're going to cure you by you killing yourself. Here, take this. You'll never have it. You want to see Jesus? Take this. But the problem is you ain't going to see Jesus taking that. I ain't going there today. Go to Luke 9. Hallelujah. a word called pharmakia. That's where pharmacy comes from. In fact, the word pharmakia in Greek means black magic, witchcraft, and sorcery. Now, look, I'm not against people taking medication in the area, you know, your diabetes and so forth. But and don't get me wrong, some people need mental medication because there's been damage. But many people are on mental medication that don't need it. Just because, I mean, you know, especially when girls go to the prisons, man, they want to put them on stuff. Same thing with guys. Man, you go to jail, they want to medicate you quickly. They want to make you into a zombie. And same thing with doctors. Look at what they've done with people that are addicted. Oh, okay, let's give them something else. They got stuff that makes you throw up if you drink. Well, how stupid can you be? So the person still tries to drink. So he doesn't drink. He does something else so he don't throw up. Does everybody get it? So they take pills. They take dope. They shoot heroin, whatever else. I don't throw up now anymore. I don't drink. Well, but you're still an addict. How many of y'all know drug addiction is evil? Amen. Look at the fruit of it. It's evil. But I'm telling you, only through the power of Christ can you be free. And then you maintain freedom. Because see, many people backslide and go back because they don't maintain connection. Jesus said, eat of my flesh and drink of my blood. That means drink my spirit and eat my word. That's how you become new. Because you can't have life. Luke 9, verse 23. Is everybody there? Jesus said to him, if you can believe all things are... I'm in Mark. I like this one, though. If you can believe all things are possible to him who believes. Praise God. Let's go on. Luke. They're brothers. In the spirit. Luke 9. Luke 9. Everybody say Luke 9. Thank you. What verse? 23. See? Everybody else knows. Aren't you glad we're not religious? I mean, snap. Let's speak it. Then he said to them all, everyone say all. If anyone desires to come after me, first of all, you got to have a desire to come after him. And if you don't, you better ask for one. Let him what? Deny himself. That's the idol. Self. And pick up his cross. Did you ever pick a cross up out of the ground? You know what it turns into? A sword. That means you got to fight to follow. And follow me. Whoever desires to save his life will what? Lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. For what profit is a man who gains the world and loses his soul? Himself will be destroyed or lost. For whoever is ashamed of me and my words, of him the Son of Man will be ashamed when he comes in his glory. So don't be ashamed of God's word and standing up for what is truth. And in his Father's and of the Holy Spirit, holy angels. But I tell you truly that there are some standing here who shall not taste death till they see the kingdom of God. You know, there's a place where you don't taste death. You just go home. Does everybody understand that? There's a place where you don't taste death. You just go. That's what I want. Hallelujah. Jude 1. It's the last book before Revelation. Actually, it's the first book before Revelation. Jude 14. So there's the two areas that connect us, the Holy Spirit and faith. Faith is the substance. The Word of God is the substance. Amen? In verse 14, what does it say? Now Enoch, the seventh from Adam, prophesied about these men also, saying, behold, the Lord comes with 10,000s of his saints. That's when we return. To execute judgment on all, to convict all who are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds, which they have committed in an ungodly way, and of all the harsh things which ungodly sinners have spoken against him. These are grumblers, complainers, walking according to their own lusts, and they have mouth great swelling words, flattering people to gain advantage. But you, beloved, remember the words which were spoken before by the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ, how they told you that there would be mockers in the last time who would walk according to their own ungodly lusts. These are sensual persons who cause divisions, not having the Holy Spirit. Does everybody understand that? Not having the Holy Spirit. But you, beloved, building yourself up on your most holy faith. Doing what? Praying in the Holy Ghost. Praying in the Holy Spirit means tongues. Why? Because it connects you. Keep yourselves in love of God, looking for the mercy of God, of the Lord Jesus Christ, unto eternal life. On some have compassion, make a distinction, but on others, save with what? Fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garment defiled by the flesh. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to God our Savior, who alone is wise, be glory and majesty, dominion, power, and both now and forever and ever and ever. So we're building ourselves up in our most holy faith, praying in tongues because of the baptism of the Holy Spirit, connecting us to the eternal throne, and by faith connecting us to the throne room and to each other, because the Word of God is substance. Now the Holy Spirit speaks through you. What's he speaking? God's Word. God's Word. Why? You may not understand it. Does anybody, look at, people don't even realize the reason why we get tongues. There's multiple things you can look up in the Eternal Library. One of the things about tongues, and we'll talk about it here in a second. Go to 1 Corinthians 14. 1 Corinthians 14. That's one of the evidences of being baptized in the Holy Spirit when you get tongues. 1 Corinthians 14. I don't know if you know this or not, but when you pray, when you're praying to God in your common language, the devil knows what you're praying. In fact, the devil knows what you think. He can read your mind. He is a spirit, and so are demons, spirit. They used to have a body. Now they need one as a host. That's why they want to live in me and you if they get a chance. So the only thing that the devil can never interpret your prayer is when you pray in tongues, because he can't interpret tongues. Does everybody get this? Now, wouldn't God want all of his children to be baptized in the Holy Spirit? But see, the religious spirits have prevented this from happening because they've infiltrated and stopped it. Many of them say it only happened in those days. Well, look at, I never even believed, I didn't know the Word of God at all. I had a visitation from the Lord, got baptized in the Holy Spirit, brought to the other side, and I remember one day I went to go talk to a pastor of a church because we wanted to do an outreach to rescue drug addicts and alcoholics in the area, and he asked me my testimony. I told him my testimony. He said, that can't be. I said, what? He said, that can't be. God doesn't do those things anymore. He's a pastor of a huge church. The Lord said, don't argue with him. Just leave. He heard it. I was walking down the church. I'm walking down the driveway, and I said, Dad, what's up? I said, he doesn't know what's what. He says, it's okay, guy. He doesn't know me. I said, but he's a pastor of a huge church. He says, he doesn't know me. If he knew me, he'd know my voice. Is everybody in it? I mean, I was, and I've seen that happen multiple times over and over and over. And it's not making us any better than anyone else. Man, I want every drop of blood that Jesus paid on the cross, I want. He paid it for me. He paid it for you. How should we neglect such a thing? 1 Corinthians 14 and verse 1. Hallelujah. What does it say? Let's speak it. Pursue what? Love. And desire what? Spiritual gifts. Everyone say gifts of the Spirit are tools. Right. You wouldn't go change a flat tire with a basketball, would you? Okay. Pursue love and desire spiritual gifts, but especially that you what? Prophesy. Are you ready? Come on, read it with me. For he who speaks in a tongue does not speak to men, but to who?
God.
To God. For what? No one understands him, not even you. However, in the spirit, he speaks mysteries. That's beautiful. So when you're speaking in tongues, you're speaking directly to the Father. You're actually praying the perfect will for your life and for others. You don't even know who you're interceding for. But the Holy Spirit is praying through you to the Father, his word, substance of faith. That's why it's coming back to you and your faith is increasing. And then all of a sudden, now what happens, because you don't understand it, the devil doesn't know what you're praying, and he doesn't know what God is sending you. So it goes into your spirit, but the devil can't access to you. When the Holy Spirit wants, he brings what he imparted in you up to remembrance, and you do something. So why? You stay ahead of the devil. So on my way to jail, I pray in tongues. I'm going places, I pray in tongues. Why? So I can get a message from the Lord. I don't know what it is, but when I get there, bam, it comes to forth. I see it, I speak it, and I'm ahead of the devil. Is everybody okay? Verse 3. But he who prophesies speaks edification and exhortation and comfort to who?
Men.
To men. I wish you all what? Oh, sorry, verse 4. He who speaks in tongues edifies who?
Himself.
What's he building himself up in?
Faith.
He who speaks in tongue edifies himself, but he who prophesies edifies the church. I wish you all spoke with tongues, but even more that you prophesied. For he who prophesies is greater than he who speaks with tongues, unless indeed he interprets, that the church may receive edification. Prophecy is the interpretation of tongues. Hallelujah. Is everybody okay? Verse 13. Therefore what? Let him who speaks in a tongue pray that he may what? Interpret. When the Lord when you're praying in tongues, the Holy Spirit will say, ask for the interpretation if he wants you to have it. So when we're praying in tongues here, there's an impartation. The Holy Spirit's given interpretation. That's what I pray. Or there's something else that's going on. Or he may be giving you an interpretation. Because there's a group corporate prayer. We're all praying in tongues. What are we doing when we're praying in tongues here? We're edifying the Father in the Spirit. You're edifying him. Okay. Verse 14. For if I pray in a tongue, my spirit prays. What's praise? Not your mind. But my understanding is unfruitful. Why? Because your mind ain't praying no more. Hallelujah. What is the conclusion then? I will pray with the spirit, which is in tongues, and I'll pray also with the what? Understanding, which is my common language. But that's the one that the enemy can attack or interrupt. But then if you know spiritual warfare, you can bind, blind, mute, and deaf those spirits that are coming against the angels working on your behalf. Amen. And your prayers. But most people don't know that. And I will also pray with the understanding. I will sing with the Spirit, and I will also sing with the understanding. Otherwise, if you bless with the Spirit, how will he who occupies the place of the uninformed say amen at your giving thanks, since he does not understand what you say? So I'm not going to stand behind this pulpit and pray in tongues to you. Nobody's going to get it. Me either. There'll be an impartation. But it's not edifying to anyone else, is it? For you indeed give thanks well, but the other is not edified. I thank my God I speak with tongues more than you all. Paul wrote most of the New Testament by interpretation of tongues. He prayed in tongues all the time. His interpretation of praying in tongues wrote these letters in the New Testament. Everything that was written was because of interpretation of tongues that Paul wrote. Well, how do you think he knew about the mysteries? How do you think he knew about spiritual warfare? How do you think he knew about putting on the full armor of God or in the keys of interpreting what was written? Remember, the Jews wrote this Bible. He knew how to fight. This is all testimony and witnesses and armor and weaponry. It's all training in this book. It's a manual. It's not religious. Glory. Hallelujah. In verse 18 again, I thank my God I speak with tongues more than you all. Yet in a church I'd rather speak 5 words with my understanding that I may teach others also than 10,000 words in tongue. Because nobody's going to get it in tongue. Brethren, do not be children in understanding. However, be in malice, be babes. But in understanding, be mature. It is written, as the law in the law it's written, with men of other tongues and other lips, I will speak to this people. Why? Because when you're praying in tongues, God is coming back to you. And yet, for all that, they will not hear me. Many will reject it. Says the Lord, therefore tongues are for a sign, not to those who believe, but to unbelievers. But prophesying is not for unbelievers, but for those who believe. Therefore, if the whole church comes together in one place and all speak with tongues, and there come in those who are uninformed or unbelievers, will they not say that you are out of your mind? That's why we try to inform everyone. We probably ought to put a sign on the doors. Tongue-speaking people. Don't fear. First Corinthians 3. And then on the way out, we need to put a sign that says, who told you that? 1 Corinthians chapter 3. In verse 9. Verse 9. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 9. Let's speak it. For he who plants... Oh, I'm sorry. For we are what? God's fellow workers. You are God's field. You are God's building. According to the grace of God, which was given to me as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation and another builds on it. But let each one take heed in how he builds on it. For no other foundation can anyone lay than that is which laid, which is Christ, Jesus the Christ. Now, if anyone builds on this foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become clearer. For the day will declare it, because it will be revealed by fire. And the fire will test each one's work of what sort it is. If anyone's work which he has built on it endures, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned, he will suffer loss, but he himself will be saved, yet so as through fire. Do you not know that you are the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwells in you? If anyone defiles the temple of God, God will destroy him. For the temple of God is holy, which temple you are. Let no one deceive himself. If anyone among you seems to be wise in this age, let him become a fool that he may become wise. For the wisdom of this world is foolishness with God. For it is written, he catches the wise in their own craftiness. And again, the Lord knows the thoughts of the wise, that they are futile. Therefore, let no one boast in men, for all things are in yours. Whether Paul or Apollos or Cephas or the world or life or death, or things present or things to come, all are yours. And you are Christ, and Christ is God's. I want to close at 2 Corinthians 6. Connecting faith, foundation accepted in heavenlies, in the heavenlies. Hallelujah. 2 Corinthians 6, verse 14. Now we have a penetrating prayer booklet, and in it there's a prayer to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Speak it, decree it, till you get it. Has everybody got it? You don't have to wait to come to church. You don't have to wait for someone to lay hands on you. Go in your closet, shut the door, and stay there till you come out with another language. and the language from above. Hallelujah. Verse 14, do not be what? Unevenly yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship is righteousness with lawlessness? And what communion is light with darkness? And what accord is Christ with Belial? Or what part is a believer with an unbeliever? And what agreement has the temple of God with idols? For you are the temple of the living God, as God has said, I will dwell in them, I will walk among them, I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Therefore means if you will do this, come out from a what? Among them and be separate, says the Lord, and do not touch what is unclean. Don't approve of those things that are unclean or you touch them. And I will receive you. I will be a father to you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. Therefore, having these promises, beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit and perfecting holiness in the fear and reverence and honor to God. Powerful. Connecting faith. Remember, one of the things the enemy doesn't never want you to do is get connected. And once you get connected, he wants to disconnect you. My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. This is the substance, the Bible. Without the Bible as being your substance, you can't be connected because there won't be any faith. Amen? Praise God. Father, we thank you for your word. We are honored and blessed. Let the seed that's been imparted in us today be protected by the blood of Christ and let it grow and bear fruit for your glory. I ask that you prepare us for communion and bring an impartation to your people. In Jesus' mighty name.